In this episode, I'm sitting down with Shannon Brown, who is an experienced and well-credentialed, very well-educated massage therapist, to do one of the sessions that we worked on to help with my hand spreading in my training for APO Worlds in Russia. Now, Shannon mentioned to me afterwards that it was important to note that although you can go out on Amazon and buy some of these tools yourself, take it easy on yourself in the beginning. Don't push too hard on some of these softer fascia. Don't try to readjust the bones or do anything you don't really know what you're doing. These tools are powerful, but very effective, and they're going to go a long way towards being able to perform some regular routine maintenance on yourself. So you can't see our faces, but this is Clay Edgen, and I have Shannon Brown over here. Shannon's been a body worker for a number of years and has all millions of certifications and millions of combinations of initials behind her name. And I work with Shannon a bit to get me ready for the APO Worlds in Russia this year. Shannon was able to help take the spread of my hand from what it was to what its full natural potential could be, or close to its natural potential.
Yeah.
And what we're going to do today is do one of the sessions that she did with me leading up to Worlds. We've traced my hand before the session, and we're going to trace it afterwards to see if we get any extra spread. I don't know why I keep looking at the camera as if people are looking back at me. But, hey, we'll get it. So, Shannon, are you going to go in dry on this thing, or do you spit on me first?
How does this work? I don't want a lot of glide, but we're going to need some, so... I'll start with just a little bit. I use a product like this one that's pasty. This is Mom's Meta, and actually has some properties that help with pain. So I usually use this or an arnica oil. I massage generally with coconut oil, but I like a little bit pastier when we're really doing something for my grip that requires my grip to work on the really hook and grab into the tissue, so you're not sliding over. This is not a spa massage for relaxation.
No, definitely not.
Definitely not.
Still have terrible sweaty dreams about some of these tools you have.
I know. So because Clay would sometimes come in either post-training, rest day, one of the things I did like to do is sometimes we would actually just, depending if he had a very sore, painful spot, we would have one arm set up with cups on certain areas, especially right here. His flexor tendons would get really tight and inflamed in certain areas, and just so I'd park the cup here to increase blood flow, and which helps with the circulation and help later on with the practice to get some of that inflammation out, any potential swelling. And then I have to do a little bit of running cups, which you need a little bit. Just a little bit of lubrication.
So it's got it sucked on there, and it's kind of moving it along the length
and
of the forearm.
With him, we can hear a lot of k-k-k-k. We call it the bubble wrap, and you can kind of feel and hear it.
And you're done with that, right?
Well, it happens on people. Runners' feet have this a lot. It's, you know, from you doing your training, the gripping, the tension. So what, you know, we're doing this just to kind of create some movement between all the layers. We have dermis and subdermis, and we have fascia, and then we have the actual fascia that wraps the muscles. There, when you have groups of muscles like flexors, extensors, quads, hamstrings, there's a wrapping of the fascia around that, and then the individual wrapping. Fascia, now they've been able to proven with microscopes that they go all the way into the fascicles and fibers of the tissue, so it looks like an orange. What we're dealing with is the layering of an orange.
That's like the kind of the skin around it, like the sac around it, and it's adhered to the muscles themselves.
Yeah, anybody look at flank steak with that white backing, that's your fascia, and if you start to pull it apart, you can see it going in. When I taught anatomy, I would bring an orange in to kind of show the layering. That's a really good example. So
it's kind of gross to think of our muscles as like an orange.
But it's very much like it. It's a really good example. So we would get some movement here. One of the things with Clay, being that we're dealing with a larger arm, and I have a larger arm for a female, that one of my favorite things to do with him would just, because the tightness recoils. So just, we do this at the nice level, later on dealing with on the other arm.
She's being nice right now because she's on camera.
Yeah, we have a tricep scar and surgery on his other arm. And so this gets very hard and so forth. So that's something that we would do where we'd have to brace him against me. But you know, being nice to getting all this lengthened out.
Now you mentioned earlier the flexors in the wrist on the underside here when you're tight. Why wouldn't you want that? I mean, wouldn't you think that like tighter is better for strength?
No, so one of the things that you and I would talked about when we first started coming in is the ability to glide. Because we want, with all these layerings going in, not everything is moving, going. So everything in here, in the groups of muscles, some will activate, some will not. Some need to activate more, like in your case, the thenar is going to work independently, more so with its own tendon. So we want everything gliding, so then you can access all the fibers of your muscle. So then we can maximize your full potential of your strength.
Okay. So we're not creating any kind of extra like length, or just kind of helping me get to the full natural maximum.
Your natural length, yeah. Yes. There is new research that's just come out that is, and when I say just come out, so, you know, research takes, you know, 6 years to populate, but something that's been published, I believe this year or last year, and it's populating through research to really start proving massage finally on a scientific level. It was done on rats, and short story is they had four groups and they atrophied three of the groups' hindquarters, and so you had a baseline and then a baseline what looks like atrophied, and then the third group was able to be released and run around, and then the fourth group had, I will send you the photo, it's very fascinating, made a little massaging for them.
Uh-huh.
So they got
a massage machine.
As a little mouse massage machine, and they got a roller, and you know, no lighting or music, you know, it's very sterile environment. And they, so basically those guys, they were able to dissect them and show the muscle growth and the proteins and everything was so much more accelerated than the atrophied and atrophied running around. So to a lot of, one of the theories out there that massage just has a placebo effect on you guys. Mm-hmm. And that it's proving, because with the mouses, you really don't have the placebo effect because they're actually cutting into the tissue and you can actually see the change. So that's really groundbreaking for us. It's the start of really proving how much we're affecting the tissue.
It's a medically justified research that shows that massage is beneficial. I can tell you on a personal anecdotal level that the work you did on me enabled me to train to kind of maximize my recovery time in between sessions, and doing two lifts a day, twice a day for 4 months. Oh God, why does it hurt?
So right here we have the muscles come down and then they start to spread here and go to the individual fingers. So they share one tendon, individual finger. So what we want to do is get in between the bone and also work on his thenar. Nice big muscle. He has the biggest thenar I've ever seen.
You know, whoa.
Yeah. There's a joke.
Yeah, you can write that down. That's going to my Yelp review for sure. Biggest thenar. You know what they say about a guy with a big thenar?
I'm not touching this.
I don't know what they say.
So just getting in. So I'm actually not, I'm getting in between the bones because that's where the little intrinsic muscles are. So that was one thing we would do a lot, work on a lot. And then I'd bring this lovely little tool in. This is actually a metal gua sha tool. So when you see tools like rock tape, tools look like this, which are myofascia tools, and Graston's a common term. They come from the tool system called gua sha in Asia. You usually see these as bones and so forth. I happen to like to work with metal. So if you want one of these tools, you can go on Amazon, type in metal gua sha, and you're going to pay a lot less money.
Yeah, I think the one you sent me to was like $40.
Yeah, you're looking at like $300, $200+ tools. Now, these are great. And we sent Clay to Russia with this, and we'll talk about that in a minute, for his recovery while training. But I told him to do not take this on your carry-on. It looks like you have brass knuckles. I do not think that very expensive tool will make it. So now I'm not trying to dig deep.
Just kind of scraping.
Scraping and spreading. And one of the things we did, is this the finger? I can't remember. This finger.
Is that ring finger? Yeah.
So I don't know if we can get, he doesn't have a finger that fully straightens, but we got it straighter.
Right.
So one of the things we worked on, because what happens when you have some injury like that,
like a pulley, I think it was.
Is a, like a pulley system, is to get that without being too aggressive to make sure we can get this as open. So because you're dealing with contractual scar tissue. So we work on this side and we were able to get it so he could activate it more. So really with him, we were dealing with this so we could activate the pulley on the finger and get more grip. Even though it's bent, he was also having trouble fully closing and fully extending. So we were able to access that finger for better grip. And since he's always contracting, one of the things we like to do is work on reopening him.
Yeah, there's a big imbalance that exists in arm lifting and grip sport, because we're so many of the events, almost all the events involve like a flexion, like a crushing something or grabbing a thick bar or pinching. There's very few, maybe only one or two, that involve the extension of the hand. And those are so rarely contested, we don't really train them that often. And so you can think about like somebody only doing a bench press and they're bench pressing four different varieties twice a day, 5 days a week. You know, they're going to get blown out shoulders and lots of muscle imbalances.
Well, and this grip will translate to powerlifting, to Olympic lifting. And where the training comes from that I learned was this past February in Florida, working with George Koulos, XBA Sports, which was a combine, NFL combine prep. And he comes from working with Bob King, who I trained with in Chicago. Unfortunately, Bob King is no longer with us. He's one of the big people behind setting up the massage team for the Olympics and also for the Chicago Marathon Pro Tent. So I first learned this technique in Chicago with marathon runners for their feet. So, because, you know, hyper arch and they're working on all these things that he used for the mileage they put in. And then when I went and trained with George, he was using on quarterback hands because the bigger the grip,
better they can hold the ball.
Better they can hold the ball. And they look for a 10-inch grip there.
10-inch between pinky and thumb? Like
yeah,
the spread?
The spread.
Would you say I have the attributes of an NFL quarterback?
Sure. I'm not going to argue with a man that's over 6 feet tall. And I've seen who's deadlift and what he can do with his hands. So, yes. And so George, I was working on people there and discussed it with me. And it was really great. He is actually, unfortunately not by his name, but was written up in Sports Illustrated about the massage therapist out of Florida who was putting this on hands. So he's sought out, but unfortunately didn't say his name. So... very intelligent man. Myofascial work is the base of what we're doing here.
And so you're getting kind of in between the bones.
In between the bones.
These little muscles, all the tendons and things that help them glide a little better next to the bones.
Yes, and it creates space. Because if you have a very closed hand, your muscle sits at a baseline. This is what we deal with in athletes. A lot of athletes is that they'll either get shortened are lengthened, and there's like a neural set thinking, okay, this is normal when it's here. You're actually a contracted state. So you'll look at people with very spread backs and very tight pecs. And so that's upper cross syndrome. What we want to do is extend the pecs and get them to reset to normal and take those back muscles and bring them back. Because then if you're dealing with something to activate your back muscles to create like a bench press and to contract your back, if your rhomboids, which is between the spine and the shoulder blade, are sitting out here, they think this is a contraction.
So we're talking about, you know, like a forward, like shoulders pulled forward.
Forward rolled,
like
yeah.
The typical bro style.
Yeah.
Walking around.
But if it's sitting at normal like this, where it's supposed to, then you contract, you have this much, which then means you're activating more of the muscle, creating more, being able to pull that bench press down. Then you're pulling in more of your pecs because they're now reset. Mm-hmm. And then, so... it's a balance with
so we're kind of
your extensors and your flexors, yeah.
Working on our, this is a kind of an imbalance treatment that we're doing to undo some of the overuse of one flexion instead of the extension. Like with the bench press example, there's always the push and never a pull. So we're getting have to massage or find some ways to loosen up those tight pecs.
Right.
And build up the weak shoulders in the back. In this case, she's helping me to loosen the tight flexors in my palm and on the supine underside of my forearm. And then I train the extensors back at the gym to help correct that imbalance. And the end result is that the hand spread stays longer and that the pain is greatly diminished. The ability to train, the ability to train longer and with higher intensities with lower risk of injury is what we're all trying to get after.
Right, your recovery level and to create more with you. We did recovery with you, but then we were also trying to make change, which you have the original drawings of how much space we made with you. So, and that's something you're gonna do with somebody which I would call professional competitive athlete. Mm-hmm. Weekend warrior, which are amazing people, or people who are just training to have gains. We might not work so aggressively to make changes in their body on the table as much as we are trying to help them recoup from their actual training and stay active in their everyday life, because they also want to go for a bike ride with their kids and they have a job that's demanding of them.
Yeah.
So different needs, like sports massage has very different needs, from recovery to helping with injury or slight injury to dealing with athletes at a pro level. When we were dealing with NFL combine athletes, they were worked on 5 days a week.
Wow. So I call this hand voodoo, but it's not really anything supernatural. It's just a regular massage, some Graston tools involved, some cupping techniques involved, and some deep tissue massage. Why it's important is, although we're never going to be able to lengthen from the base of the wrist to the middle finger, we can increase the spread of the hand. And that's really important for things like pinch grip and thick bar, where, you know, with my hands are just about 8 inches from middle fingertip to crease of the wrist. If I can get to a 10-inch spread here, pinky to thumb, I can wrap that around a Rolling Thunder or an axle a lot easier and fully realize all the strength I've tried to build in my forearms. If you don't have mobility, say you're trying to learn to squat and you don't have the mobility in your hips to get down to a proper depth, that's going to inhibit your ability to fully actualize and realize the strength that you're trying to build. So we have to work on mobility first, build range, then build load, right? Everyone says that. Build the range of motion, and then you can add some load to it. In the case of our hands, for grip sport and for arm lifting, we want to build the range, and then we can build the load.